this is the context. The context is this. When Jesus just fed 5,000, actually more than 5,000, 5,000 men. So that, in other words, is somewhere between 15,000 and 20,000 people. All right, 15 to 20,000 people, Jesus fed with 5 loaves and 2 fish. 5 loaves and 2 fish. It's a pretty crazy miracle that just took place. But see, whenever something amazing happened, you are challenged to take a position. Okay, I don't think Jesus ever leave you hanging there not taking a position about him. You got to take a position about Jesus. Either you think he's a lunatic, a psychopath, or a liar, or he's a teacher that's just gone the wrong way, or he's the Lord of this universe. You got to make a determination about that. You have to judge. All right? He's forcing you to make that. Jesus does not leave you room to say that Jesus was a nice guy. He doesn't. Okay? You can tell the person next to you that you're a nice person, but you can't say that about Jesus. You can't say that about Jesus. You may be a nice person, but Jesus doesn't want us to just say that you're a nice person. He wants us to know who he is. And so doing something that amazing, I mean, could you imagine seeing something like that right in front of your eyes? 5 loaves and 2 fish and fed 20,000 people. Wow. All right. Right away, all these people want to make him the king. Everybody's following him. Yeah, Jesus. If Jesus is our king, he is our God. Guess what? Buffet every day. Right? Isn't that what we want? Free food. All right? We're all freeloaders. Come on. And so, right away, Jesus changed his kind of tone. You know, instead of feeding people, he right away challenges them. You guys came here because you had your stomach filled, didn't you? You know, right away start challenging them. What I want to give you is not to satisfy your stomach. What I wanted to give you is something that transforms your life. Isn't that what you're looking for, my friends? Isn't that what you're here for? Why are we here on earth anyway? Why are we here on earth anyway? Isn't that something every one of us is asking? We go through the mundane routine of life, go to work, go to school, and then go to sleep, and go to eat. You know, the cycle of life. For the longest time, even though I was a Christian, I was struggling with that. I have thoughts about, why do we even bother eating? The same thing. You chew it up, it's just like stuff. You, today, I actually enjoy food. Okay, don't get me wrong. That was in the past. I enjoy food a lot, okay? But there was a time where I actually thought eating food was a waste of time. Because you're just chowing down protein, chowing down some, you know, fiber, chowing down some kind of stuff, and then you put it in your body, and then it becomes energy for your system. Might as well get some energy pills, and everybody takes them in and zap, and you don't need to eat anymore. What a waste of time. That's what I used to think, obviously. But what is this life all about? Why are we feeding ourselves? Why do we need energy by going to sleep? Why do we go to work? What is this all about? There's more to life. And that's what Jesus is trying to get at. And when he started getting at that, some people get offended. Okay? Are you offended when somebody declares to you there is a better way to live? Better way to live? In other words, are you saying I'm wrong? Are you saying the way I'm living is not right? Are you saying I'm worse off than you? Come on. You know what I'm talking about, right? See, whenever you say there's a better way to live, you're kind of saying, hey, there's something wrong with the way you're living. Okay? And that's what he's saying. There is something wrong with this world. There's something wrong with the way people live. You can't keep going like this. He's saying you need to refocus and think about what life is all about. And people start grumbling. You know, a whole bunch of people left. And there was only a few people left behind. And the question I asked you guys was, why did you come? Why did you come in the first place? Why did you come in the first place, if not to look for something better? Or are you here for food? I think our Chinese, our lunch is not bad, but but it's not enough to draw anybody here. I don't think so. Okay? But what is it that you're looking for? If it's not the Word of God. And then that's how Peter responded. Listen, you have the Word of God. You know? If you didn't come here for the Word of God, why are you here? Why are you staying? You know? And so this is the story kind of after that. And people's already polarized, you know. You got one camp that likes Jesus, another camp of people say, we hate Jesus, we want to kill him, you know. It's kind of, Jesus polarizes people. He kind of divides people into different camps. We like you, we don't like you, we like you, we don't like you. He does that in our world. And it's crazy. And that's how people end up in wars, battles. And I don't think that's the intention of Jesus. Jesus came to share love. But we end up fighting because the world has a way of rejecting truth. And when you hate the truth, you want to put it out because what it does is tells you that your life isn't right. You know, no one likes that. Okay, so let's look at verse 14 and 15, okay? I don't want to make this really long, but I just want to, I need to zip through these verses. Verse 14, would you read it with me one more time? Not until halfway through the festival did Jesus go up to the temple courts and begin to teach. The Jews there were amazed and asked, how did this man get such learning without having been taught? And the word that they're using is actually saying, how come this person never went to school and he's able to do all these kind of things and say these kind of things? Obviously, he's got some wisdom. And, you know, our society is no different from 2,000 years ago during Jesus' time. Our society is no different because today we honor those people with a degree. Come on, somebody say amen. We respect people with a certain position, you know, of stature in the society. We look at someone who's, you know, if you're a pastor, you have to become a reverend. Okay, so you're a pastor because you graduate from a seminary. Some people won't call you a pastor because you didn't graduate from a seminary. You didn't get a degree. You can't be a pastor. And some people say after you become a pastor and you got to be a reverend because I'm so scared of that title, reverend so and so. It's scary. But you know that's how our society is. You got a PhD, so we have a certain high expectation of you, and the rest of you, you're just normal people. Okay? Tell the person next to you, you're just normal people. Okay? All right. And then when we see someone with, you know, nice clothing, someone who looks like they know what they're doing, all right, we have a high regard for them. Ooh, the rest of you, stay in the corner. Don't make noise. Be quiet. You know, kind of thing like that. That's how it is sometimes. That's how it is with our world. Our world has a way of looking down on people and uplift certain people. But you know right here, what does the passage say? Okay, they were making fun of Jesus because he didn't go to school. He didn't go to the rabbinical school like everybody else, all the other rabbis, all the other teachers. So he didn't graduate from seminary. See, I want to teach you a simple principle from the Word today. I think I'm learning, and the Lord is reforming me, because when you go to school, you want to exalt education. Somebody tell me amen. The more you're educated, the more you want to exalt education. I'm not saying education is wrong. I'm not saying education is bad. But I'm saying that you don't get anointing from education. Amen? All right? I think anointing is greater than education. Now, Jesus is able to say what he said because he had anointing, not because he went to school. All right? And that's why he spoke differently. And people said, hey, where did you get that authority? How come you can say this without resorting, say, so-and-so once said, without saying, oh, I did this research and this is statistics, and that's why I'm saying this right now. You don't say this because there's a certain authority, because there's anointing. Are you with me? So anointing is greater than education. I mean, there's a friend of ours. She's successful in business. All right, very successful in business. Her and her husband, they created this business together. But you know, the biggest problem I have with her is every time I'm talking with her, I get this sense of inadequacy. She feels like she doesn't belong there. She said, because I didn't go to school. But she's a successful businesswoman with her husband. I mean, it's not a small business, all right? They're making good money. But you know what? Every time she talks, it's like, I just feel like so bad inside. I just wish God would show her how precious she is. You know, you don't have to be educated by the world standard. You don't have to have the stature that the world offers you for you to be success in God's kingdom. Somebody say amen. All right, you don't need it. What you need is the anointing from God. Anointing supersedes education. Okay, so how do we judge? We judge people based on their stature. We judge people based on their titles. We judge people based on what cars they drive. You know how silly that is? We know, okay? It's stupid. All right, and let's go to verse 16 and 17, all right? Jesus answered, "My teaching is not my own. It comes from the one who sent me. Anyone who chooses to do this will, the will of God, will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own." How do we know if this teaching is from the Lord? How do we know? We know if they are doing the will of God. All right? How do we know? I can tell you, obedience confirms authority. Obedience confirms authority. When a person is doing what God wants them to do, authority comes with that. All right? A lot of people can talk a good talk, but there is no authority behind what they do. You got to be able to do what you preach, and when you do what you preach, okay, and the preaching obviously comes from the Lord. If what God tells you to do and you do them, there is authority behind what you're doing. And I you know, you guys probably heard this man before. Pastor Allen's friend, Eric Tietz. Was it Tietz? Tietz? T-I-E-T-Z? Something, I don't know how to pronounce his last name. But anyway, you know, he's a big man, you know. And when you see him, he's just jolly good, you know. It's like really a friendly, big, huggable guy, right? And then when you see him, you just want to give him a hug, right? And he runs this organization called Heart of Compassion. Today, they feed thousands of people on a weekly basis, okay? And where do you get all that food to feed thousands of people? Well, there's a lot of donation that comes, you know, from different organizations, supermarkets and stuff. They just donate a bunch of, you know, food. They have a big warehouse full of food, okay? You go to their warehouse, it's like almost like Costco, but not that big, obviously. But you know what I'm talking about, right? But let me tell you something. For someone to have that much resource to give to somebody who doesn't have any resource, it's an authority, okay? How many of you say, "I want to do something," and you're able to do it? A lot of times we can't, okay? And this guy says, "I want to feed the poor," and he's able to do it. And to have the money and the resource to feed the poor, I can tell you that's real authority. That's authority. Because Jesus fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. I think that's authority. It just came from, not from his pocket, came out of nowhere. Somebody offered it, and he was able to multiply it. That's authority. And if you ever talk to Pastor, you know, Eric, he'll tell you his life story. And I can tell you from his life's testimony, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy serving in a regular church because he has his heart to serve the poor. He wants to give, but you know what? People give him a hard time. You ever had this happen to you when you want to give and people give you a hard time? Yeah, it happens all the time. It happens all the time. If you want to give, people give you a hard time. Now, but God has his anointing upon him. And so what? He got out of the regular church system. Now he has a system. He has a new following, not in the regular church context, but he has a following of a whole bunch of poor people and people who are helping the poor, working for him. You know, I think that's authority. Obedience confirms authority. When you want to do what God wants you to do, isn't that what God wants us to do, to take care of the orphans and the widows? Isn't that what God wants us to do, take care of the poor? Isn't that what God wants us to do, take care of the children? You know, when you do it, the obedience confirms your authority. Obedience is not something that you can do on your own. Obedience comes from following the way of God. When you follow his way, when you follow his will, and every step you take, God is going to confirm your obedience through authority. He gives you authority. That's what happens. And a lot of people want to talk about doing good things, but doing good things confirms the authority. Okay? Now, you know, you guys know, all know James Cho, right? James Cho was in a Starbucks. You met that pastor guy that what's his name? Gerald.
RJ.
Was that Starbucks? You know, we've been talking about this motel kids stuff, right? The motel kids, right? What are these motel kids? Motel kids are these families. They're not poor to the extent that there's shelters for them, but they're not rich enough to have a permanent address, all right? Or a permanent dwelling. So they live in these motels, and then they have children, you know, they're beautiful kids. And then James Cho's been talking about, you know, going out there, and we've actually been out there a few times. And then he was one day at a Starbucks and looked at this guy and looked like his homeless guy, right? He just went up to introduce himself. And turns out he's not a homeless guy. He just looks like it. Okay? And then because they met, they were able to connect and gather a lot of resource to support these motel kids ministry. You know, it's about anointing. It's about God using us through our obedience, demonstrate his authority taking place. How do you know? Walk in obedience. Then you know the difference, how to judge rightly. Okay? So, verse 18 and 19 says, "Whoever speaks on his own, their own, does so to gain personal glory, but he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is a man of truth. There is nothing false about him. Has not Moses given you the law? Yet not one of you keeps the law." All right? Doing it for whom? Who are you doing it for? You know, if you're doing it for God, all right, you're gonna have the blessing from God. If you're doing it for men, you're gonna have the blessing for men. You know, a lot of times people work together. When you work together in a very close environment, people have the tendency to step on each other's toes, right? Come on, toe stepping, right? Because everybody walking really close, and that happens. I rub you wrong way, and you rub me the wrong way. It happens, right? What happens when you're doing it for yourself? What happens when you're doing this for yourself and you somebody step on your toe? Who are you? Who are you to step on my toe? Okay? See, that flesh comes out whenever you're doing it for yourself. Okay? But when you're doing it for the Lord, no big deal. No big deal when people step on your toe. Right? And that happens a lot in ministry. It happens a lot of times when people say, "We're doing this for the Lord." Uh-huh. Everybody wink together. Uh-huh. "We're doing it for the Lord." Uh-huh. Why are you taking it personal? Uh-huh. The reason you're taking it personal is because you're not doing it for the Lord. Uh-huh. Right? You see what I'm saying? A lot of times people take it personal when somebody do something to them. Ooh. It's about me. You're kind of blocking my shine, you know? All right. So you're taking that glory from me, man. What's up? So if it's not about you, it's okay, right? It's okay when somebody does something that, you know, kind of rub you the wrong way. It's okay. No big deal. Got to take the flesh out of the spiritual work. Got to take your own glory out of God's glory. And I tell you, this is daily struggle, isn't it? Somebody say amen. All right, because everybody wants to take a bit of that glory, come on. That ego, feeling good about themselves. No, just me? No, nope, nobody wants some ego. No? You guys are too holier than me. Too holy. Now, you got to look at this situation. You look at this person and say, does this person benefit? What does he benefit from the gospel? Okay? What does he benefit from the gospel? Nothing. You don't benefit nothing from the gospel. Why would he be doing it? He does it because he's doing it for the Lord. Okay? We got to know the difference. So, who are you doing it for? Who are you doing it for? It's very important. Okay? And then you see verse, toward the end of verse 19 and then 20 and 21 says, "Why are you trying to kill me?" Jesus said. "You are demon-possessed," the crowd answered. "Who is trying to kill you?" Jesus said to them, "I did one miracle and you're all amazed." How many of you ever been called demon-possessed? Anybody? Oh, demon-possessed. I've been called demon-possessed, okay? Okay, do you like it too? When somebody calls you, "You're demon-possessed." How do you like that? No? It's pretty cool, huh? Got some lively demon in me. Yeah. It's not a good feeling. You know, you're like, what's up with you, man? Why would you think I'm demon-possessed? What did I do? What did I do to... You know? Jesus says, they're trying to kill me. You guys are trying to kill me. How would anybody know the heart of another person? Obviously, Jesus would know. But when a person got the revelation from God, you can tell other people's motives too. Okay? When you walk with the Spirit, you're clear about what He wants you to do. Sometimes you can look at people and right away you know their motives. All right? Some people got it more often than others. But you know what? God can do it all of us. God can do it to all of us. All right? So what Pastor Sam said earlier, that can happen to you. All right? Now, don't think of it as a trip, you know. I get to know your heart. I get to know your situation. No, don't think like that, all right? Because every time God uses us for a special purpose, what is the purpose? To minister to people, to bring Him glory, right? There's a purpose. And if you're not doing that, guess what? You're abusing the gifts. Don't abuse gifts, all right? You know, allow the gift to flow out of you and be comfortable with it. All right, don't take pride in it. Hey, I got special gifts, you know. Don't do that, all right? So right here, you have people that want to kill Jesus, but they don't want to admit it. They don't want to admit it. Because what do you think Jesus is doing? Jesus is just being blessing people. But you know, all the enemy wants to do is accusation. Accusation. Think about it. Every time there is work of God, there's a ton of accusation that comes. Whenever there is a work of God in an amazing way, in a breakthrough way, I can tell you there's going to be a ton of accusation come. All right, you guys may not hear it. I hear it. I hear it even in the church. When we start doing more outreach ministries, guess what? Accusation's going to come. Accusation comes. All right. When we first started the ministry here, you know, actually, I want to share with you some of the accusation. All right. You want to hear some accusations? No. You want to hear some? Be one very interesting one. All right. Somebody told me. Told me that somebody said, this is an accusation, that I came to this church so that we can take control of this church and kick everybody out. So when we kick everybody out, it will be only me running the church, and I'm going to sell this property for money. Yeah, that's a good idea, though. Get rid of everybody. Get out of here, guys. Get out of here. Get out of here so that I can take control of the church and sell it for money. No. Everybody wink with me. Uh-huh. Man, accusation comes. They come left and right. Accusation come top and down, you know, everywhere. But you know what? As long as we're blessing people, it's blessing or accusation. How do you know? How do you know who's on the right? Who's the one who is unto God's heart? If you're blessing people, are you accusing people? That's it. Okay? Because men of God, women of God, will not be full of accusations. They'll be about blessing people. And that's what Jesus did when He fed the 5,000. When he healed the blind, all right? He made the lame walk. Wow. He's blessing people. Jesus bring blessing, all right? Not accusation. And praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for all the outreach that we're doing. And I'm not going to hear any accusations. Okay, so here it goes on. Now, verse 22 and 23 says, yet because Moses gave us circumcision, though actually it did not come from Moses, but from the patriarchs, you circumcise a boy on the Sabbath. Now, if a boy can be circumcised on the Sabbath so that the law of Moses may not be broken, why are you angry with me for healing a man's whole body in the Sabbath? I mean, think about it. What is a healing? Healing is just restoring that person back to the way God had made. Okay? Healing that person, make that person whole again. All right? Is that something wrong? Nothing wrong with it. But why would people be complaining? Well, obviously, the Sabbath is considered a holy holiday for the Jews. All right? That is the day you're not supposed to work. But see, there is that law that was passed on. That was that law that was passed on, the circumcision and all that stuff. Now, what is circumcision really all about? To circumcise a child on the eighth day of its birth, so that this child will be reminded of what? Reminded of the fact that God is with them, that God had chosen him to be his people, all right, to be his child. So when you teach the gospel, when you bring someone to wholeness, you're restoring that person's relationship with the God who made him. It is the same thing. It is the same thing. You're doing the same thing. You're helping this person realize this person belonged to God. Just like these people perform circumcision so that this child would be reminded that he belongs to God. I don't know how that does it, but you know, that's just what they believe. Okay? All right, if you were an adult that went through circumcision, I think you remember that. But if you're 8 years, you know, 8 day old, I don't think you remember that. Anyway, I thought that's pretty funny. But you guys have no sense of humor. It's okay. think about this. A lot of us are so caught up in the letter of the law that we forget the meaning behind it. What is this circumcision? Reminding people that they belong to God. And you heal someone's heart, you remind them they belong to God. Heal somebody's body, you remind them they belong to God. What is the difference? My friends, so many times we emphasize the law and the rules so much more than the meaning behind everything. And this is something I want to share with you, is that we need to love life more than traditions. Tell the person next to you, say, we need to love life more than traditions. Love more. Love more, not the tradition. Who do you love? I love tradition. You know, some of us really love tradition. If you're really honest, most of us like traditions. Somebody, tell me. Most of us, we love traditions. Okay, you may not know it, but I can tell you, you may hate other people's tradition, but you love yours. Are you with me? Every generation criticized the previous generation, their traditions, but they have their own tradition. Let me share with you our family tradition. When our kids were really young, I really tell you, it's almost near impossible to be parents. Somebody say amen. You children, you got to understand this, all right? Because when your kids are young, you want to create traditions for them. Amen? And so that they can celebrate, have a great time, and remember your traditions and value your traditions. Yeah, you do. And so on Sunday morning, we have this family tradition. Everybody played this game called Rock Monsters. I'm sure Jacob might remember that when he was growing up. That's all we did. Rock Monsters every Sunday morning. Because the reason behind the Rock Monsters on every Sunday is so that we can get everybody in the car on time. Because it's really hard, all right? Every tradition had a reason, right? There's always a reason we start a tradition. The reason we want everybody get in the car quickly, because Rock Monsters are coming. And on Sunday morning, they usually chase us all the way to church. And we go to church and everybody's freed, come out. And then on the way to the church, they take out this water gun, imaginary water guns, and start shooting at Rock Monsters and Jell-O. Jell-O is one of those things that kills Rock Monsters, right? And so once in a while, on a Sunday afternoon, we'll visit Rock Monster Mountain. Okay, we go and venture into our third floor downstairs dungeon and go see Rock Monsters and destroy their hideout. You know. Anyway, so everybody loved it. We always have a great time on our way to church, right? And the unfortunate thing is, kids grow up, they grow up and then they don't celebrate my tradition anymore. They don't necessarily say, oh, come on, Dad, that's kind of old, you know. Rock monster, who believes in rock monsters? Sunday morning comes out, get killed by water. Right? So guess what? Guess what? We don't play rock monsters anymore. Who's the one who's disappointed with that? I created the tradition, and I'm the one who's torn because, like, oh, nobody play rock monster anymore. And they don't. And you know, there's a tradition where I used to beat every kid on video games, right? I used to be the guru. I used to be the number one, but it's not like that anymore. See, my friend, is traditions are built because there's reason behind it. Traditions are built because it makes sense for the time. But we have to learn to let go of traditions and pick up some new traditions. Are you with me? All right? I'm not saying doctrines are changing, but the meaning behind it stays. The reason we play rock monsters so that we can get to church on time. That's all it was. And we have a fun time together as a family. Right? Now, if we kept those two things, is go to church on time and then have a fun time together, isn't that accomplishing the tradition? But a lot of times, all we do is fighting over traditions, fighting over how to do things and what ways to do things and make it right and perfect. For who? You know? To you. Maybe not for another person. See what I'm saying? All right? And that's what we fight over. And you know, it's, we all have to do this very simple thing. And it's hard. It's get over ourselves. Okay, tell the person next to you to get over yourself. Get over yourself. Yeah. Got to get over yourself. If you don't get over yourself, you're in trouble, man. You're in trouble because you're going to hold on to certain traditions that nobody appreciate, and you're the only person that, how come nobody's coming here? Nobody wants to come here because you're holding on to something nobody wants to hold on anymore. It's too late. It's the 21st century. We don't do that. Okay? We got to move on. Which one do you love more? Do you love people or do you love traditions? Traditions are for people, you know. Okay? They don't exist for themselves. Traditions don't exist for themselves. And that's why Jesus is having a disagreement here. It's about loving people, isn't it? As long as you love people, it's okay. You know, I'm not saying you can do all kinds of crazy things. I'm not giving you okay with that. You might have to talk to me afterwards, okay? All right. So verse 24 says, this is kind of like the ending of the sermon right here. And it says, stop judging by mere appearances, but instead judge correctly. All right, how do you judge correctly? Don't just look at the appearance. And how do we not look at the appearance? Because that's all we know, is to look at the appearance. Because we can't judge people by their heart, just like God. God knows all our hearts, and we can't judge people by the heart. How do we judge then? How do we judge? The Bible tells us you judge them by their fruit.